Relax my stress level. There it goes.
Okay, but we lost Jeff.
There's Jeff. I think we're all live now. Yeah.
Chill out on the call. I'm here.
Okay. Alexis, are we live? I do not know the answer to that.
Yes.
Okay, I guess we are live, and I can't even, this is the strangest beginning to any of these sessions because I've got an expert on technology and social media, and I've got a director who's going to talk about the pre-release of his documentary, and I don't even know how to operate the system, but that's what happens when you have a Luddite trying to interview someone from the 22nd century. I always begin with a strange story. And for Tristan, my strange story is that I did not want to take the meeting with him. That we have a mutual friend who does finance. And he said to me that there's this really fascinating guy who knows more about technology than anyone. I know nothing about technology, obviously. So I'm begging, please don't make me do this. And so I agree to see Tristan for 15 minutes. And within the first 5 minutes, I'm thinking, why the hell is he meeting with me? It's not that I didn't want to talk to him. I was fascinated by it. You were called the world's first technology ethicist. And Jeff, I'll get to you in 1 second. You are, according to Atlantic, the idea of a conscience for Silicon Valley. I've gotten to know you as a brilliant wordsmith for what you're trying to do. And this interview will be the toughest for me because I know the least amount of material, but it'll probably be the most important of all that I do on these Fridays with Frank. Tristan, this issue of technology and social media, every time I get together with you, you're more agitated, you're more emotional, you're more passionate. What is scaring you so much about technology and how it is affecting humans? And Jeff, hold on, because I'll get to you in 1 second.
Yeah, well, first, Frank, thanks obviously for hosting this in front of your community, because I've been lucky enough to attend a couple of the other ones that you've done. And I thought this would be a great, you know, opportunity to go deep on some of these issues for, you know, the policymakers, the administration folks. Just really honored to do this with you. And that meeting for me was really interesting because you'd also only had about an hour of sleep. So I could have been just living inside of your mind warp at the time. Your standards were lower. But I mean, I think, and I'll kind of bridge this to the film and Jeff, who directed the film, but I think anybody looking around the world right now and saying, what is going on? Why does the whole world feel like it's going crazy at once everywhere? Like you have people believing in conspiracy theories in every country. You have vaccination rates going down in every country. You have, you know, polarization going up. You have more extremism going up. You have more people isolated. You have more, you know, teen girl depression, suicides in most of the Western countries using social media. Is there something that's connecting all this? You know, we actually even were writing a piece right now for Time and talking about how, you know, if you went back to the 1960s and said, you know, suddenly you're getting more migraines, you have a little bit more of a headache, and the person down the street, your neighbor, they had a kid and they had a kid with a birth defect. And when you go down to this, you know, to the bus stop, you see a bunch of dead birds on the ground, but you wouldn't have any reason to say, is there any reason why all these things are happening at once? And of course that was DDT or, you know, this before the silent spring, the environmental movement, the birth of, hey, maybe there's this invisible force that actually might be connecting some of these common ways that our society seems to be going crazy. And the reason that I've been so concerned for a really long time now, and it's only gotten worse, and Jeff can say, because we started working on this film together 3 years ago, and before that, well, I'm sure we'll introduce him and show the trailer, but you know, it just struck me that what's gonna happen is technology is only gonna get better and better and better at overriding or overwhelming the human mind and shaping what we're feeling, sensing, believing about the world. Because oftentimes you think about Facebook as just like another button on my phone. Like I've got all those different colorful buttons, those apps, and I can hit that one or I can hit a different one. But what we fail to see is the way that these systems like YouTube, Facebook, Twitter have actually become the central infrastructure that all the rest of the world is built around. Because even if you say, well, cable news actually influences the world more than social media, well, guess where the cable news people are picking up their stories? They're looking at Twitter all day. So the way that these social platforms are sort of constructing our reality, I think, has become an invisible force of society. And the digital fallout from that has been, you know, higher rates of depression, mental health, teen suicides for especially young girls, more addiction and isolation. Talk about just the productivity of just everybody just being sucked into the 24/7 kind of drip by drip cycle.
But hold on. We also have more information. We have it faster. We have it unedited. We can get what we are looking for. We've democratized, essentially, the web has democratized information. Isn't that a positive?
Yeah, democratizing information is great. In fact, if I could, I would give everybody a cell phone with a Google search box and Wikipedia yesterday. I mean, this is not an anti-technology conversation. I think the challenge is we have to look at the business models that are governing these platforms that run our lives, because their business model is caught in this trap, this race to the bottom of the brainstem to harvest and hijack human attention, or even frack for human attention, go lower and lower into the limbic system. And that is the core problem.
You got to stop for 1 second. Race to the bottom of the brainstem.
Yeah.
Fracking. I've never heard that before. That's new. You've got better language. You're better at this than I am. So I hope you realize that. Where do you come up with these phrases? Well, that's why you interviewed him. That's why he's part of your video. Go and in 1 minute, we'll do the video. What are you trying to accomplish with all of this? What is your overall objective?
For me personally, and I'm, you know, and I think with the film, I don't think there's a better way to solve these problems than to make everyone in the world aware of them at the same time. Because right now we're inside of this kind of digital matrix that's kind of running our thoughts, and no one can climb up to a perch above and see what is this doing to all of us. And so for me, the most important thing is that everyone understands how this works. Because if I understand how it works, but I'm just one person, I'm a teen girl, and I say, I don't want to do this anymore. So I pull out. But then all my friends are still gossiping about me on social media. They're still, you know, the cute guy that I like or whatever is still over there. So I can't actually escape the system unless everyone else also knows. If I say, you know, don't believe that 5G causes coronavirus or the anti-vaccine stuff, then I can believe that, but that doesn't control the fact that I still send my kids to school with a bunch of other people who are still jacked into Facebook, Twitter, et cetera, that are still steering people towards more and more crazy extreme stuff in general. And so the biggest thing we can do is make the whole world aware of it, which is always why I've respected your work, Frank, because I think what we share in common is that public information, public communications is its own mechanism for changing how the world works. And that's why I think the film is so important.
Tristan, could I offer...
Yeah, I know. Actually, I want Tristan to introduce you, Jeff, and I want you now is a good time to show the trailer. And by the way, for those of you on this, and we got a good turnout today, you're going to be the first people to see this. This is not aired yet.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is, the trailer, which just came out yesterday, but the film has not come out yet. And so this is the first conversation we've actually ever done on this. So I will share my screen, and then Jeff, I'll introduce you right after that. Just so you know, Jeff is the director. Let's see here. Window. How's this? Does that work?
Yes. Yep.
All right. 2 minutes.
When you go to Google and type in climate change is, you're going to see different results depending on where you live and the particular things that Google knows about your interests. That's not by accident. That's a design technique. What I want people to know is that everything they're doing online is being watched, is being tracked. Every single action you take is carefully monitored and recorded. A lot of people think Google's just a search box and Facebook's just a place to see what my friends are doing. What they don't realize is there's entire teams of engineers whose job is to use your psychology against you.
I was the co-inventor of the Facebook like button. I was the president of Pinterest.
Google. Twitter. Instagram.
There were meaningful changes happening around the world because of these platforms.
I think we were naive about the flip side of that coin.
You get rewarded by hearts, likes, thumbs up, and we conflate that with value and we conflate it with truth.
A whole generation is more anxious, more depressed, I always felt like fundamentally it was a force for good. I don't know if I feel that way anymore.
Facebook discovered that they were able to affect real world behavior and emotions without ever triggering the user's awareness. They are completely clueless.
Fake news spreads 6 times faster than true news. We're being bombarded with rumors.
If everyone's entitled to their own facts, there's really no need for people to come together. In fact, there's really no need for people to interact.
We have less control over who we are and what we really believe.
If you want to control the population of your country, there has never been a tool as effective as Facebook.
We built these things and we have a responsibility to change it. The intention could be, how do we make the world better?
If technology creates mass chaos, loneliness, more polarization, more election hacking, more inability to focus on the real issues, we're toast.
This is checkmate on humanity.
Okay, you're scaring me.
Yeah, it's a scary reality. I'll do a brief intro of myself and then tie it back in, because Tristan, what you were talking about just a couple minutes ago, I really want to just to add some thoughts to that. But Tristan and I went to Stanford together. We met each other, yeah, you know, when we were back in school many years ago. And ironically, a couple of years ago, I saw Tristan posting on Facebook about this after he did his first Anderson Cooper piece on 60 Minutes talking about the manipulative nature of these algorithms and the tech companies. And so a couple of years ago, Tristan and I started talking more and I started learning from him all of these concerns. My background as a filmmaker was with two big films called Chasing Ice and Chasing Coral that were in the climate world. And when Tristan and I started speaking about this, I saw the parallels between the extractive nature of the fossil fuel industry and what Tristan is talking about here. And I wanted to just offer some connection of some dots, Tristan, to add to what you were saying a second ago, because I think it was really, really helpful for me to look at Facebook and Google and Twitter from a very different lens than what they are selling and what they're marketing and the way they talk about themselves. And along the same lines, like as you were saying, Frank, there are great positive things that can come from these platforms. They sell and advertise themselves on these, the ability to connect, to talk to anybody for information to spread. But if you look behind the scenes, like how are they actually making their money? Like what makes Facebook and Google so profitable? These are the most valued companies in the world, basically. And they're not selling the ability to connect to your friends. They are selling to advertisers the ability to manipulate the public. They are really at their foundation, they are manipulation companies that have—
Hold on. That's a word I've always hated, because it's a word that has been used against me by people I don't like and who don't like me, that the language that I use is manipulatory. So Facebook wasn't founded to manipulate.
It wasn't. No, it wasn't. But it morphed into this different thing. And I'm completely— there are lots of different ways we can communicate different things with clarity, with simplicity, with different ways to frame language. But literally what Facebook and Google are offering to the world, whether it is somebody trying to sell a pair of sneakers or for political purposes or what have you, they're offering the ability to get access to the largest database of people on the planet, to independently isolate them based on all the data that's been collected about them, and to share very specific messages that can be tested over and over and over with that particular audience. So in some ways, it's really refined targeting that they are selling at scale. And this is one of the ideas that we're really trying to bring to light in the film, because the way that the companies are actually fundamentally structured, the way that they profit, the way that they make their money, is not the thing that the general public has access and insight into, that level of nuance. Tristan, were you going to add something there? I saw you.
I just saw Richard Dreyfuss's comment come in, which was kind of a moment for me, because I love Mr. Holland's opus, and seeing him on Fridays with Frank a few times ago. And what he's talking about as well is that in the race for attention, the race is to get us to move faster, because faster attention making is going to outcompete a company that's trying to do slower doses of attention. So if someone's offering 2-hour documentaries, and that's their YouTube, let's call it DocuTube. DocuTube would be massively outcompeted by Institute with like lots of 7-second videos, which is TikTok. And so the problem is the game theory, that race to the bottom of the brainstem, is who can go faster, burstier, yeah, sweeter to your nervous system. I want to hijack your limbic system. And that competition is always going to produce the kind of the worst outcomes of human nature as the default settings that get lifted up to the top of our collective conscious. And that's what's, I think, so dangerous.
The point that I was wanting to get to there, like the business model that drives all of the financial value of these companies, once you have that the attention business model in place, that's where all of these other tactics to grow time, grow engagement, that's where the profit comes in. And this is where you get from one like world state to a very different world state, because now as a function of the algorithms trying to constantly optimize for attention and engagement, we get filtered into infinitely a different number of filter bubbles and echo chambers. Like, we don't have a shared reality. If we all watch the same news channel, if we all read the same newspaper, if we all see the same billboard, we can have a shared conversation around like where our society is. But my front page to the internet via Facebook or Google or what have you is completely different than yours, completely different than Tristan's. Like, literally everybody's getting their own Truman Show version of reality that's being self-reinforced. And from my perspective, like, it is making information immediately available that has no regard for truth, that has no regard for fact-checking, that has no regard for kind of our higher selves and our higher thinking. And as Tristan's saying, that race to the bottom of the brainstem, whatever works will go out really, really rapidly.
Guys, gotta let me in. You're so bright. You're so brilliant.
Talk through here.
And the two of you are the same. It's like it's you both speak a mile a minute, and I don't know how you guys do it. Would we be better off if we did not have this? Is it so bad? This is the first question I got for you, and I'm already 6 questions behind. Would we, as a country, as a society, should we wish that we would go back before Google and Facebook and Twitter and all of this?
Yeah, I mean, just to also link this in to the answer to the question with what the film is kind of describing, you can see in the trailer, it's the first time that the people who actually made these products back in those days, so back in 2004, 2005, the people who were early at Facebook, early at Pinterest, early at Instagram, early at Twitter, saying, you know, these are the problems. And I think one of the things that's very hard for the public to hear that there's a problem here, unless the people who make it also say, just like the insider with tobacco, right? I mean, that's the playbook, is you have the people who make it say, yeah, we built this thing and this is what it's doing to people. And that's what excites me, I think, about getting people to see, well, what might the world have been like if we didn't go down this path, because here were the people back then in 2004 making the decisions. Tim Kendall, who's in the film, is the guy who brought in the advertising business model into Facebook. And he talks about it. He says, you know, we had this admiration for Google, that they had this really simple business model, you know, and this service was giving people lots of good. You just type in what you want and it always gives you, you know, infinite research. It seems wonderful. And that business model works so well for them and we admired them. But why don't we want to just bring this into Facebook? And that's what Twitter did as well. And so you start seeing how, you know, these services, one decision at a time, lead to that race to the bottom of the brainstem. Now, where would we be without them? I think that we'd be in a very different place. I really think that I actually hope people watch the film and go back in time and saying, if I was wearing this pair of glasses to see reality through, which is the outrage colored glasses, show me things that will get me to click, which means show me things that'll make me angry. Over and over and over again. And so imagine like you're in your house and you're wearing the outrage colored glasses. So when you look in your kitchen, all you see are the things that your spouse left in a different place than where you last left them. And all you see is where there's like you can see the sneeze where they sneezed on the handle of the refrigerator. And like, so the glasses would be showing you all the things you should be upset about. It's like the character Iago in the Shakespeare play Othello, who's whispering in your ear saying, here's just something else you might want to think about those other people. And what would your mind be like if you ran 10 years of that process through life? It would really warp your whole psychology, which is exactly what it did to Othello back in the play. And I think that's the kind of effect that Twitter has. And Twitter, Frank, I hope we later get into kind of the breakdown of conversation, because it's never been easier with Twitter to take someone's comment out of context, do context collapse, and then say something ironic and outrageous about, isn't it ridiculous that this person would say this thing, and then build a mob off of the least charitable interpretation off of what someone says and create more chaos. That's what Twitter is letting people do at scale. So we're gonna get into all these different topics, but I think the point is the world would look dramatically different if we had not got down, especially the Facebook and Twitter and YouTube roads in specific ways. It's not against all technology or all smartphones. It's very specific business models with specific effects.
At this, you created a film, but specifically, what needs to happen so that it doesn't destroy our conversation? Or maybe we're too late.
Jeff, do you want
to? I'm starting to draft my own, like, these are my solutions, which this is a very complex issue, right? There's no silver bullet here. I think it really comes down to, like, we need to change this fundamental business model and the incentives that are misaligned for society. I think we need to give the public greater awareness about what algorithms are and how they work and give the public control over those algorithms. Those algorithms are dictating what all of us see. They dictate the information, they dictate our values in an unknown way. And they are mirrors of ourselves. So whatever you feed into it, it's just regurgitated. We have a great quote from one of our subjects. Algorithms don't predict the future, they cause the future. They are just kind of this recursive machine. I think we need a department of algorithms. Like, we need full on insight. We shouldn't have opaque algorithms that are dictating how people get jobs. Like, prison sentencing is based on algorithms. This is drifting into a different part of the algorithmic conversation, but there's no transparency into how algorithms work. I think we need a change at a bunch of these companies. But the big thing ultimately, like what we're trying to do with the film is just to start the conversation and raise awareness. There's been so many attacks on all of these tech companies for the last several years now. We're trying to distill it down and tie everything together with this film to show all of the cascading impacts that we're seeing. So some of the comments that are just happening, like the way we relate with each other, the way we interact with people, our ability to just have humane conversation. As Tristan was just saying, like, you can have a conversation on Twitter that turns so quickly to outrage in a way you would never do with a person face to face, right? We've removed beyond human parameters the way the technology has been built. And in some ways, like, in this search for connection, we've really disconnected ourselves from each other and from humanity. So I don't know, from my perspective, this is like a huge, the reason why this was so meaningful to me in learning all of this from Tristan, like, this was Inconvenient Truth in 2007. This was Silent Spring many decades ago. Like, we're at a reckoning right now with the way the technology has been built that requires a complete rewrite.
Yeah.
Hey, you, which company are you most afraid of? If you had to choose just one that keeps you awake at night. And by the way, I just want to warn people on the call that there is a huge thunderstorm that is right over my neighborhood. And so if anything happens, if the lights go out, it's just because of lightning. Pick a company that you think has done the most damage.
I think if we pick different companies, we'll get more coverage, Jeff. So yeah. I'll pick Facebook. Hopefully, you'll pick YouTube. I would say Facebook and YouTube are the two most alarming, and there's for very specific reason. When we use the phrase, as Frank will know, using language, if you use the phrase social media, let your mind conjure up what pictures come to mind, like which specific companies come to mind when I use that phrase, social and media. You don't think of YouTube. It actually escapes your mind's associative network, right? But YouTube is actually quite, like, it's actually just as big as Facebook, and it's the broadcasting system for the whole world. And what does YouTube do? It's trying to recommend, obviously, the most engaging next thing. So if you imagine a spectrum, so I don't know what you can see in my hands here. I do a spectrum, and on one side of the spectrum, you have the calm side of YouTube, old Walter Cronkite videos, like, you know, calm news reporting. On the other side, you have Crazy Town. You have the most extreme conspiracy theories. You have anorexia videos. You have, like, you know, all the crazy stuff. No matter where you start as a human being, like, you could start watching a Walter Cronkite video or you could start in Crazy Town. But if I'm YouTube and I want you to watch more, the next video I'm gonna recommend to you, which is my business model, is I have to get you to watch that next video. Am I gonna send you that way towards the calm side? Or am I gonna send you this way more towards Crazy Town? I'm always gonna tilt you towards Crazy Town, which means that I'm gonna tilt the entire playing field of 2 billion people. There's more than 2 billion people who watch YouTube in, you know, dozens and dozens and dozens of languages that the engineers don't even speak. And what that's done is if you were a person, you watched a 9/11 news video, it would recommend 9/11 conspiracy theories. If you were watching a moon landing video, it would recommend flat earth conspiracy theories, which YouTube recommended hundreds of millions of times. It recommended Alex Jones conspiracies about Sandy Hook parents being crisis actors and all this kind of stuff. It recommended Alex Jones 15 billion times. It recommended, anyway, you get the picture. Oh, the last example is if you're a teen girl and you watched a dieting video on YouTube, it would recommend anorexia videos because those would be more extreme. The algorithm would say, oh, that user, they tend to click a lot more on that. And so that's the problem with YouTube, is that it's actually spun the world into these kind of outrage machines. And it did that for so long in this slow process across every society and just tilting the world by just 3 degrees. And then you just blur your eyes and you say, why is everyone believing all this crazy stuff? It's because that's the information that they've been fed. And so that's the YouTube side. Maybe Jeff wants to take a different one.
Yeah, I really resonate, Tristan, with everything that you're saying there. I think there are a lot of different people that critique the tech industry as a whole. And there are very different arguments to be made about Amazon and different arguments to be made about Apple and different arguments about Microsoft, et cetera. But I think where Tristan and I landed quite a bit in the Facebook and YouTube and Twitter triumvirate and Google search, I would put, nobody thinks of Google as a search, as a social media platform either, but that is a really critical place where information is being algorithmically filtered out and reinforced. And I think that's where, for me, the things that have been the most concerning are when news gets blended in and is getting propagated by the algorithms in a way that is shifting and literally polarizing the way the country sees itself and each other. So I would agree, Tristan. I'd put Facebook and YouTube at the top of those lists. As a point of comparison, there are places where you see conspiracy theories running rampant and other, like Vimeo. You don't hear about conspiracy theories running rampant on Vimeo. You don't hear about conspiracy theories running rampant on Hulu or on Netflix or on HBO. Like there's video content on those places where there's a subscription business model, right? The incentive for Netflix or for HBO or for Hulu is to give you entertaining content that you like watching. And they're curating with human curation. They're giving you content that you like. Meanwhile, YouTube is just letting anybody dump anything into the system and will let the computers figure out whatever sticks with you. And it doesn't matter. Like if you look at somebody's YouTube recommendation on the side, right, it feels like you're looking at their dirty laundry. It's like, this is the most inner private secrets of what this person's watching in, you know, late at night. And oh, it's that, like, I don't even know what my YouTube feed would be right now, but it really is. Whatever the hell works on you is what they're going to show you. And that has led to these rabbit holes based on these incentives.
Yeah.
By the way, I want you guys to look at the commentary and look at the questions. You can pull some.
Yeah.
I want to expand it a little bit. Bill Hawkins says, what has social media done to relationship skills?
Yeah.
You're telling me about anger. What about relationships?
That's a, go ahead.
I was going to say, we didn't include it in the film, but there are people that we've been talking to about how teenagers can't maintain eye contact with other humans anymore in the same way like adults do. Like we are, like youth are being so, they're living in a completely new world compared to our generation and above, right? And older, like their entire lives are being shaped and morphed and framed based on the incentives that these platforms have established for them. So their social value is being perceived through Instagram likes or TikTok feedback, right? And the ability to have face-to-face conversation, the ability to have long-form nuanced conversation, right? With the Twitterification of the world and everything getting crammed into shorter and shorter things that are just more likely to regurgitate, like we've moved away from the ability to have complex nuanced conversations with other people.
Yeah, obviously, I think with kids, it's really most harmful because developmentally, children have certain stages they have to go through and they have to be, you know, cared for well at those stages. So I think one of the subtle things that phones do for children is they actually rewire the way that your attachment needs get formed. So you learn to attach to the phone. One of the things that's not in the film, we do talk in the film about teen suicides and depression, especially among young girls between 10 to 14 years old. That's the stat for 10 to 14 year old girls in the US. both admissions to hospitals for high depressive symptoms and also teen suicides have gone up pretty significantly. But one of the interesting things that I learned from talking to some researchers in the field is another reason that kids are checked in for self-harm into the hospitals is not because they feel bullied on social media, but actually because they lose access to the phone, because their attachment needs are so formed with the phone is like their lifeline for communication. Mm-hmm. And it's really deeply kind of taking over the sense of identity and self-worth. It wasn't designed by child psychologists. And what we say at the end of the film is, look, the only thing you actually really need to know is that ask anyone in the tech industry, do you give your own kids social media? The answer will almost always be no. That's actually all you need to know. The CEO of Lunchables Foods didn't let his own kids eat Lunchables Foods. That's the only thing you need to know. What do you do when you ask your doctor? You say, hey, you know, well, what would you do if you were in my situation, if it was your kid? That's how you know what people really think, right? You ask them, what would they do, not just for, you know, their friend, but for their own child. And that's the easiest way to know what good.
Okay, so then answer that question. Most of the people on this call have kids, and some of them, by the way, I've got a lot of my students on this as well. What should they do? I've got a student who actually did he called it detox, and he actually got off social media completely, got offline completely, and for 2 weeks refused to go online. And the emails piled up and the texts and all that. But he considered detox, and he said to me he felt better. It was hard for the first 3 or 4 days, and by the time he was done, he said, I can do it, and I just feel happier. What do you say to parents of kids right now? Go ahead.
I've stopped using all social media when we started working on this project. And I basically have done like a 2-year-long detox now of social media, where I was super addicted during the last election as well, like on the phone all day, checking Facebook and Twitter all day long. And it actually felt like a real addiction that I was weaning myself off of, that I had to replace with other triggers. For me, I think the most important thing, and as Tristan was saying earlier, this is not an anti-technology conversation. This is being aware of when the technology is a tool for you versus when it's not. Like right now, we're using awesome technology to be able to have a conversation, and we can have this shared conversation through a technical platform. This is aligned in our interest. Like, we are all opting in for this nuanced conversation through this platform. FaceTime is a great technology. Zoom is a great technology. The phone emails are great technologies. But when the technology is pinging you constantly and trying to get you back, that's where I think you can look at, what are you paying for? What are you not paying for? Where are the incentives aligned for you versus not aligned for you? And being able to sort of identify, like, is this actually benefiting my life or not? Like, is this a tool for me or not?
Yeah, I would add to that this is not an anti-technology conversation. And for parents out there who are wondering how to, you know, I mean, this is especially hard in coronavirus times, right? We're about to, I've been seeing videos of other parents who are literally putting their kindergartner in front of a Zoom, you know, call on a laptop. And like, this is like, this whole conversation is about what is inhumane about today's technology, right? Where is it not ergonomically? I see Richard Dreyfuss using the word ergonomic, which is actually the foundation of our use of the word humane. Jeff Raskin, the first father of the Macintosh at Apple, his son Asa is a co-founder of the Center for Humane Technology. And his dad wrote the book called The Humane Interface, about humane technology is respectful of human needs and considerate of human frailties. And right now we have technology that's exploitative and extractive to human needs and frailties. And so the difference that Jeff is describing is, if you make a FaceTime call, like, Frank, if I call you on FaceTime, there's no business model that's trying to make FaceTime have me call you more often, show like streams of hearts and likes and get me to go back, and I leave and then it says, Frank still wants to talk to you. Like, there's no business model that does any of that trickery, none of that sneakiness, none of that crazy stuff. And that's how you know when a product has your best interests at heart. FaceTime is just sitting there like a hammer waiting to be used. But social media is not sitting there waiting to be used. It actually has goals. I mean, the simple way to know about this is, if you try, like, your student to actually delete your Facebook account. Have you ever tried to do this? You know what it shows you? It says, by the way, here are photos of 5 friends that are going to miss you when you're gone. Now, did Facebook, when you hit delete on your Facebook account, did they stop and say, let's go run over and ask those 5 friends, are they going to miss you when you're gone? No, they are just inventing that these 5 friends are going to miss you when you're gone. That's what we call persuasive technology. That's selecting those five photos that are going to be the most compelling to create the most loss aversion. That would really hurt if I would lose contact with those things. And technology is exploiting all those instincts. So all the business models of advertising and engagement are bad because they're about pulling on and exploiting those interests that are not aligned with your interests. And for kids, I mean, anybody who the business models are not that, like this, like a Zoom even, or FaceTime, or Khan Academy education software, nonprofits, things like that are fine. They're great. In fact, I would say desktop computers, where you get to really open your mind and do creative things. That's what I grew up on. I worked for Apple when I was 18. You know, like Jeff and I were actually both in our background at Stanford, Apple campus reps back in the day at Stanford. And we believe in the creative power of technology. It's just that that's not the way that we've gone because of this business model of harvesting attention.
So fix our political environment right now. Is that it's not just a cancel culture. It is this ugliness, this brutality that social media encourages. How do we fix that? That's the number one question I'm getting.
I think we need to reinstate the fairness doctrine. The political polarization that we're seeing on CNN and MSNBC and Fox is just the same thing. It's the advertising business model, just less effective than it online. Like online, it is hyper-targeting everybody individually, and the way the media has been shifted now that are advertising-based is providing the same functions, just in a slower pace. But as Tristan was saying, like they're being fed based on their own feedback loops from the technology. I think the fairness doctrine is a really, really important thing. We used to have laws around how news organizations needed to cover both sides of issues in a fair and balanced way. And that was overturned. And that kind of gave rise to a shifting news landscape that has drifted us further and further away from a shared story.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is one of the hardest and most important questions of our time, because we've now arrived at a state where this has landed in as culture. So now culture is walking around with bad malware code, where we actually want to think and make the least charitable assumptions about what anyone says ever. Right? That's now running in us, not in the technology. That was running in the technology, allowing us to create these outrage mobs. Like, oh, Frank said this, and he uses one word that's wrong or off. So I'm going to go build a mob and say, do you see that Frank's saying this? And do you know that he did this other thing? And technology is not designed for forgiveness or for evolution or for growth. It's designed for creating the easiest reaction and instant outrage, because that's what gets the most attention.
And by the way, you created instant outrage. Richard Dreyfuss just did an all caps statement. So you're doing it right here.
Yeah.
So Amy Kramer asks, who decides whether it's good technology or bad technology? Should I trust you?
Well, clearly Jeff is the most authoritative person in the world. Yeah. I think it's a very nuanced question. I think the easiest thing to ask is, when does technology designed or incentivized with your best interest at heart? Did Snapchat hire lots of child developmental psychologists like they used to do on Sesame Street and saying, oh my gosh, we have an hour or more of children in their developing brain sitting in front of us. We have a duty of care. We have a responsibility to get that right. So they hired child developmental psychologists to say, what are we going to do with this like footprint of human mind brain time that we are going to be responsible for cultivating? And they hired people who are experts in that. Now let's switch over to Snapchat and Evan Spiegel sitting there in Venice, California, in LA, who's a 24-year-old guy from Stanford who, you know, is a couple years behind me in class. He's designing the streaks feature, which shows the two kids the number of days in a row that they've been having a conversation together, which is a manipulative technique that makes it so the two kids, they have a streak of 150 days. They don't want that streak of 150 to go away. Do you think Evan has child developmental psychologists on staff that are asking, like Sesame Street, how do we care for children? We are so far away from where we used to be when we actually made values-driven choices. I think of, you know, Sesame Street, I think of Mr. Rogers, I think of, you know, Walter Cronkite, I think of people who actually had values about what does it mean to be a responsible gatekeeper for information and for truth. Not truth, that's a strong word, but for delivering powerful information that we know is going to be consequential. We used to have media ethics, and we know that in the history of journalism, that yellow journalism got us into the Mexican-American war, right? And that's how we got the Pulitzer Prize out of it. So the problem with social media is it actually turns each of us into yellow journalists. We are the yellow journalists now. And the question is whether we're going to reverse course before we enter into Civil War, World War III, because it's going to happen because of that same force. But now we have to not be those yellow journalists, which is why this film, I think, is so important at creating that public awareness to get out of that state.
Definitely no promotion. You've mentioned the film 7 times, and no one has ever promoted anything as much as you have. So you win that award. Jeff, don't you do the same thing in the film that you're doing now, which is, aren't you trying to trigger a response? You're trying to get people to react emotionally to
what they see? I mean, I think all communication, right? You're trying to showcase, we're trying to set up a logical argument in the film. We're trying to set up a worldview. We did our best process to interview a lot of people and to come to a perspective. I think going back to this part of the conversation and what we were trying to hit in the film is to get people to think critically about when is technology serving our interests or not? And when are there huge consequences that come as a result of that technology or not? Just from that earlier comment and back to Amy's question, like this is an oversimplification in many ways, but there is this common phrase, like if you're not paying for the product, then you are the product. Like there is no free lunch. Like what is Facebook worth to you? How much would you pay for Facebook? What is the value there? And it seems as though a lot of people, according to the research that I've heard, a lot of people wouldn't want to pay Facebook for the product, which is why they're profiting more through this advertising model than they are through a straight subscription model right now. But that's the thing, like I pay a lot of money for Adobe Photoshop and Premiere as a tool that lets me do my craft. I pay a lot of money for my computer or my phone as tools. But where's that value exchange with the company that has my interests at heart, that is doing things for me, the customer? That we've invented this new business model around free products in exchange for attention. And this business model, I think, is as problematic as what we've discovered drilling fossil fuels out of the planet, right? Like we once thought, hey, look at all the power we get out of oil and fossil fuels and look at how awesome it is. And now we've seen many years later the consequences of those fossil fuels. I think we're going through that same shift where we've now discovered that extracting attention from human civilization for a business model of advertising has huge, huge consequences on countless layers of the whole stack of human civilization. And so this is the reckoning that we have to go through right now, is to realign those incentives.
Guys, this will be on, it comes out the 9th of September. I need to cut this short because I will literally end up just like this in the exact same place on Fox News in about 2 minutes.
Okay.
I don't give these compliments easily. The two of you, I get why you've known each other for so long. You scare the shit out of me. I think you explain it incredibly well. And this has been probably the most valuable conversation I've had on Fridays, because you're raising something that we need to do something about. It's not just telling interesting stories. It's really getting inside our heads and what we need to do in society. And Tristan, I'm going to ask you, when I end this, which will be probably at the end of September, I'm actually going to have you come back after the movie comes out. And just, I'm going to do a bunch of people for like 20 minutes each. But sure. There's my call. Guys, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Frank.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, everybody.